about developing a sadhana based on a mantra om chanting. Is it a proper way for practicing jnana yoga? And how should I do this? If there's a specific pitch or frequency for chanting mantra?
Okay. Yoga Sutra, your Magna Carta, your main charter says, Tasya Vajaka Pranava. His word is Om. Om is described as the Alpha and Omega. The beginning and the end of everything. In Japan, in front of Buddhist temples and sobas in gates, two fierce looking guardian kings are kept. They are known as Neo statues. One has an open mouth, regarded by Buddhists as symbolically speaking the A syllable, and the other has a closed mouth, symbolically speaking the syllable. The two together are regarded as saying Om, the Vajra breath or the absolute. There are also lion dogs found in Japan, Korea and China, also kept in pairs before Buddhist temples and public spaces. And again, one has an open mouth, the other closed. Open mouth is known as Agyo and the other is known as Ungyo. This is to show that Om is the beginning and the end. Some scientists are of the opinion that the universe emerged from waves. In my opinion, those waves are nothing but sound. Indian culture believes that the first emergence in the universe is that of sound. So Goddess is exalted in India as Shabda Brahmamai. The sound is the expression of ananda or experience. The consciousness emerged as manifest universe in experience. It is for experience and it is by experience. It further means that experience or ananda was the cause and the experience was the effect. Ananda was both the cause of the universe and the effect of the manifestation. So the sound is expression of experience. That is why Saint John says, word was there in the beginning. So we can arrive at a conclusion as this. If universe or manifestation is sound, the soundlessness or the silence is the state where nothing exists. That silence is our real realm. It is from that silence we have emerged. So we have a natural affinity to silence and we maintain as nostalgia. It is like homecoming. Just like a kite coming down to the branch of a tree after much flying here and there in the sky, we unknowingly love to return to our source, the silence. The silence is the being and the sound is the becoming. The silence is potentially contained with various forms of sounds. These variations form further emerge as different particles of the universe. The basic sound further differentiates into broad spectrum of swaras. Swaras, you know, saptaswaras, seven notes. For our convenience, we classify them as seven notes in music and all. Now you can see the single sound being projected as seven different notes, like white color being refracted into vibhyur. The division into variety is complete and perfect here. The silence is ekam, one and only. Evam, it is alone. Advitiyam, it is one without a second. It is nirapeksham, it is independent. And swayam kritam, it is originated from itself. From such an entity called silence, the sound emerges into variety. The variety is not one. It is not alone. It is fully dependent on another and originated from another. The emerging sound is called the Shabda Brahma. It is a primeval sound, that is pranava, that is Om. That is the essence of the universe. It is the seed from which all waveforms of sound emanated. In that way, it forms the bindu, the point of convergence and divergence. The consciousness converts into Omkar, the point. And from that point, the universe diverges into multitude. Omkar is the beginning of all imaginations, kalpana, and resultant universe which is illusory. So in order to enter into the silence, our original realm, we have to go through the point or the bindu which is called Omkar. That is the importance of Omkar. We drop variety of sounds and resort to the pranava, which is a gateway to silence. From the perspective of consciousness, Omkar is the gateway to the manifest universe with variety. From our perspective, or in the view from manifest universe, Omkar is the gateway of the silence to the nothingness. It is a window to eternity and freedom. The Upanishads further portray manifestation of the universe as a threefold process. There are vibration, radiation and materialization. We call it Nada, Bindu and Kala. Have you heard that? The Omkar lyrically and phonetically represent the three. Nada is there. O is there. The Nada is lyrically represented like this. Kala is there also. As U, U, and Bindu as M. So lyrically and phonetically, Nada, Bindu and Kala are represented. There are four stages for this Nada. Some scholars say there are five stages also. First is Para. Para represents the transcendental consciousness. It is just vibration. It is synonymous with Ananda or the bliss. In whatever form we experience bliss in this manifest universe, it will be accompanied by vibration. At Mount Sinai and at Hira Cave, prophets said to have been shivering with bliss when they received that wisdom. In Tantric rites, vibration is a physical emanation. After Para, Kashmir Saiva school has introduced Sukshma. This is regarded as the manifestation of the astral. It's the beginning of the astral. May not be misunderstood as the beginning of the astral subtle sound. It is beginning of the astral universe. till Sukshma, the universe had been causal. Now it has become astral. Next is Pashyanti. It means being seen. Seeing what? Seeing intentions or Icha. So this is the place of Icha Shakti. It's the beginning of willpower. So in order to see, there must be duality. So at Pashyanti state, duality comes into existence. There are two. This is the beginning of variety. Next is Madhyama. The middle point between the manifest and the unmanifest. This is called a stage of formulation. Formulation of Jnana Shakti, wisdom. Next is Vaikari. Vaikari state comes and it is the materialization or the color. Kriya Shakti or power of doing is represented here. From being, we come down to the doing. Cross represents this, the being and the doing. The vertical is being and the horizontal is doing. Vaikari is called the Jagrat, wakeful state. Madhyava is Swapna, the dream state. And Pashyanti is Sushupti, the deep sleep state. And what is left is Turiya state. The Panjavaha system of Kashmir Saiva school attributes Sushma state to Turiya. And they reserve the para for Turiya Dhida state. Normally we learn that para is Turiya state here in all other schools. So Omkar starts with withinness. The Omkar starts within us as para. It becomes visible or audible to us as Pashyanti. It becomes clear at Madhyama. It becomes louder at Vaikari. You may please understand that after Vaikari, it returns to para again. It is like a cycle. The truth, this may not be seen in text, but when you practice, it becomes clear to you. The cycle is cycle of samsara or jagat. The cycle of samsara or jagat. Jaga, coming and going. This is why Upanishads have talked much about Omkar. Taittiriya Upanishad says, Om iti Brahma. Brahma is known as Pranava. All that here is a manifestation of Pranava. Pranava accompanies all actions performed as a part of sacrifice. Atharvana Upanishad says, Om is the true reflection of the Srishti or the universe. Prashnavarishad says, even if one does not fully realize the true import of the single word Om, nor comprehend the constitution or basis of it, by one's thought and partial meditation of it, should enlighten the person concerned and ensure the attainment of birth next on earth. Chandogya Upanishad opens with the recommendation that let a man meditate on Om. It calls the syllable Om as Udgita, song, celestial song, chant, and asserts that significance of the syllable is thus. Why Udgita is important and how it becomes important? The essence of all beings is earth. The essence of earth is water. The essence of water are the plants. The essence of plant is man. The essence of man is speech. The essence of speech is Rigveda. The essence of Rigveda is Samaveda. And the essence of Samaveda is Udgitha. Udgitha is Om. This is how Chandogya Upanishad describes the importance of Omkar. I need not add all Upanishadic quotes here. Yogi says that it is from Omkar which contains A, A, U and N, which are the basic sounds which can be produced without using the tongue. A, U, N. These are the three sounds which can be produced without using the tongue. This is what yogis say. Like three primary colors which create secondary colors, A, U, N create the entire world of sound. Now I must come to the practice of pranava meditation now, as I was theorizing things. After I have suggested to some of our friends a different way for Omkar meditation. After deep inhalation, exhale fully with the sound O without joining your lips to make the M. After deep inhalation, exhale fully with the sound with chanting O without joining your lips to make the M. But listen carefully at the end whether you are listening to the M within you, M within you. So inhale and exhale fully with O and listen for the inner M. The consummation of the pranava happens within you. One day you will hear the M within you without your effort to make it. And that is anahata. This is a very simple practice which you can try. O silent. O silent. Like that. One day you can hear within you. And that is an experience. That is what I have got to say.